Why are you looking at me like that?
You're listening to me.
What are you going to talk about today?
You said Genesis 3.
You know what happened in Genesis 3?
Yeah.
Okay. You want to read it?
No.
Yeah, I got burnt. Hey, read that because it's on my breath.
You can't be belching on your breath and then having me read at the same time.
Okay.
It's one or the other.
Okay, let's read down to 7 and stop.
Genesis 3 in the NLT. The man and woman sinned. The serpent was the shrewdest of all the animals the Lord God had made. One day he asked the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat the fruit from any of the trees in the garden?" Verse 2. "Of course we may eat fruit from the trees in the garden," the woman replied. Verse 3. "It's only the fruit from the tree in the middle of the garden that we are not allowed to eat. God said you must not eat it or even touch it. If you do, you will die." Verse 4. "You won't die," the serpent replied to the woman. Verse 5. "God knows that your eyes will be open as soon as you eat, and you will be like God, knowing both good and evil." Verse 6. "The woman was convinced. She saw that the tree was beautiful and its fruit looked delicious, and she wanted the wisdom it would give her. So she took some of the fruit and ate it. Then she gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it too." Verse 7. At that moment, their eyes were open, and they suddenly felt shame at their nakedness. So they sewed fig leaves together to cover themselves.
What did you think about that?
I read, so now you talk.
I've heard this, talk a lot of times, many years, and, I don't know, maybe I wasn't listening. Maybe I wasn't paying attention. But the key thing for me, it says about him being with her pretty much the entire time.
Who was with her?
Adam. It says she took some of the fruit and ate it. Then she gave some to her husband who was with her.
So you're saying that the whole time the serpent was talking to Eve, Adam was standing.
Was he there? Was he not there? It doesn't explain. But based off of reading it here, it says, "So she took some of the fruit and ate it. Then she gave some to her husband who was with her." What are you trying to do?
Keep talking.
It goes back to talking about, I guess for me, this verse teaches us about us here present day, male, female, how we are, how we interact with the world, what how things affect us. I guess for Eve, she got so caught up in the beauty of everything, the wildness of everything, and Adam failed to put down his foot with her and say, "No, man, God told me that I am not going to eat from this tree, regardless of what you think or whatever this person is telling us." No. So she convinced him that out of him knowing who God was, she was strong enough to convince him to eat from that tree, even though he knew it was wrong. That is just shocking to me, and it shows you the power of Eve.
Is it power of Eve or power of persuasion?
It's the same thing. And it was so interesting how it talks about the serpent was talking to her. So was the serpent another person? Was the serpent an animal?
What is a serpent? It's an animal.
Okay, right. So what I'm trying to say, because I've never heard these things about how the animals were talking at one point. The animals had to be talking, because it says right here, he said, where is it at? "You won't die," the serpent replied to the woman. So, we didn't go any further in the scripture about what God cursed the serpent after that. And the serpent has never been able to speak again.
Has any animal been able to speak? Is it that the serpent was speaking English? Or Eve understood
English or whatever language it was.
Yeah. Or is it that Eve understood the serpent language?
Either way, they were speaking, they were communicating.
Well, then that means they could still be speaking. It's no different than when dogs bark, they're speaking, but we just don't understand it. But they're still bark. It's still their language.
But it says it's plain that it was spoken.
Yeah, but it didn't. What is your takeaway from here that you feel people should have the same takeaway? What are you getting at?
Meaning, basically, we go throughout the Bible, I'm talking about marriage, how it all incorporates with everything. A lot of people don't know that pretty much the wife runs, well, she ain't gonna run it, but she manages the household. She's the manager of everything.
I disagree.
You don't think so?
No.
She don't manage it?
No.
So what is it then?
She does not manage it. It's specifically in the Bible. It says that God gave Eve as a helpmate. Never says she managed or did anything. That was the responsibility of Adam. She is a helpmate. What happened in this situation was Eve was out of order, period. And Adam allowed her to be out of order because he allowed her to make the decisions without consulting with him or allowing him to make the decisions. Eve doesn't manage anything.
No, I wasn't meaning to manage it where she everything is going to go through the husband, but how it was, I guess, basically here, where like if the husband had to go somewhere, whatever, he had to entrust into his wife that she was going to be there, you know, to make sure everything was taken care of. Honestly, you know, everything is going to end up going through the house if it's done properly anyway. It boils down to him anyway. But just trying to say, you know, show people how much, if you don't have a strong wife and easily persuaded, how much destruction it can cause. How much destruction it can cause based off of that. Basically off of what she just did here. How much destruction comes from that? And it just applies to I'm bringing it back everyday things.
But I also have a question. For many, many years, I was upset with Eve, right?
You was upset with her?
Yeah, I was upset with Eve. I said, Lord, if I ever make it into heaven and Eve is there, I'm going to have a conversation with her. But the reality is what we all fail to understand is we are all responsible for our own actions. So the sin did not, you have to understand when Eve ate it, nothing happened. Nothing happened when Eve ate. When things change is when Adam ate it. So think about this, if she would have ate the fruit and Adam never did, we wouldn't be in this situation. It didn't happen until Adam ate it. So at any point, Eve could have been eating and eating and eating, and Adam said, no, I know the word. I know what I'm not supposed to do. I'm not going to do it. We wouldn't be in this situation today.
If Adam had stood on his authority, what he was supposed to do.
Regardless what Eve did. So to me, Eve did not have the power, because when she partook of it, nothing happened. It wasn't until after Adam did it. There was no power. There was nothing that happened when Eve did anything. So to me, she didn't have the power. The power or the law, whatever it was given to Adam. The instructions was given to Adam. They were not given to Eve. And so to me, again, the man who is the head of the household has a responsibility to make sure that the household is in order. Because if he would have stood his ground and not partaking of it, we wouldn't be here. He could have rebuked Eve and said, you know you're not supposed to do that. You disobeyed God, but he didn't. And it's the order of correction in the households that are broken right now.
Right.
That's the problem. Yeah. And too many people have put too much emphasis on the woman's role and the woman doing this and the woman doing that. No. Right now, if you look, the majority of the households are run by who? Women. Part of the reason why the society is in such disarray. It was the responsibility of the man. And again, for years, I was so upset with Eve. If Eve just didn't do that, I wouldn't have menstrual cramps.
Are you serious?
Yeah, because that was the consequence of it.
No, I'll definitely.
But again, all Adam had to do was shut it down.
That's
stay
true.
In his
but,
ground.
Yeah, that's why I didn't want to get misconstrued with the word manage when I said it. You know, basically, you know, I was saying it not in an actual like, oh, you know, the man is obsolete. She does it and that's it. No, that's not the way I was saying it. But you're totally correct. So basically putting it in today's marital, is that a word? I don't know.
Marriage, or are you talking about today's marriage?
Marriage. But anyway, today's marriages and how. So you're saying basically that regardless of what the woman does or how she thinks or whatever the case may be, the man should be holds his rightful place, authority or something, whatever.
Yes, and I believe it is his responsibility to, you know, provide correction.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Problem is the men aren't in their place doing what they need to do, forcing or allowing the space for women to now step into that role. And that's not their place. That's not their place.
You said the men are not what?
They're not doing what they're supposed to do in the households and be men. There are so many households without men and or strong men who are doing what they need to do. You have to be the example. And if you have these men not being the example, how do you think the household is going to be? It's going to be in disarray.
Are you able to give an example of, you know, this would be interesting to hear from a woman's perspective, a strong woman's perspective. What, like, if a man is watching this or something, what is maybe an example to show, like, okay, he's not being strong, or whatever the case may be, yes. A rightful man or whatever.
You know, something I heard, and I probably said it before growing up, was do as I say, not as I do. The dumbest thing.
Who said that?
It's a saying. People used to tell their kids all the time, do as I say, not as I do. What kind of foolishness is that? That is the problem with a lot of households. You have parents trying to correct their children on things they haven't even done. Mm. So if you are a father and you're telling your child, hey, you shouldn't be out there running in the streets, partying, getting drunk, and every day you come off work, you come home and you get lit.
You partying, you getting drunk.
Or you just sitting on the couch like, man, I had a rough day. Let me throw down a couple of them. Yeah. Like, seriously, you want somebody to respect what you say when you yourself
are doing the same?
You're not doing it.
Yeah, that's true. I have seen that. That was a great example. I have seen that a lot, you know, especially with me dealing with a lot of people in the past few years. I've seen that.
Hey, don't be cursing.
I've seen that a lot.
And every other word that come out of your mouth is a curse word. And your thing is, well, I'm an adult. I'm a parent. I can do it. Do as I say, not as I do.
Oh boy, when you grow up, you know, don't make sure you don't smoke, you know, cigarettes or something like that. But you smoke all the time, you know.
So again, it's not, if everybody took their proper position. But I guess before you can take your proper position, you have to know what it is. You have to know what your role is. And it starts from Genesis, the beginning, the instructions and order that God gave man.
Yeah.
Period.
He gave, he did. That's
you
right.
Have a lot of women running the household. A man can't say anything. And even if he says, well, I don't want you to do this or I don't want to do that, guess what? The woman goes, do it anyway. Women are out of order, men are out of order, therefore the household is out of order.
And therefore it's chaos, and that's chaos, and here and there. So, well, I know, I was going to ask the question, like, so what is the way to fix it? I already know the answer. Go to the Word. The Word gives very great instructions on how we are to manage ourselves here on earth. Manage marriages, you know, managing your children and stuff like it is in there. You know, it's in that Bible, and a lot of people don't know how to do it because a lot of people, man, look at that book and just be like, man, that's too much, man. I ain't reading that. That can't tell me nothing. But not until you start reading it and understanding it for yourself, you're like, man, this thing has so much power in it. Why isn't it that so many people don't want to read it more?
Probably because what it has been used for in the past. Let's just talk about households. The government recognized that households without a strong father, the women will do what? Start relying on the government. Mm. Many men were removed from the households. Back in slavery time, that's what they did. They removed the men. You know, they didn't want it to be a strong unionship, because when it's a strong unionship, it's harder to infiltrate. It's harder to break down. And the sad thing about it, it's just like the Bible. What have people used the Bible for? Control.
Mm.
Fear.
Mm.
Right? And so a lot of people don't view the Bible like they used to. They look at it as a method of control.
Mm-hmm.
If I do what's in the Bible, I'm going to be bored. Mm. I'm not going to have fun. I'm not going to lie. Growing up, there was a list of things that I could not do that all of my friends were doing that I thought, oh my goodness, they're having so much fun and I can't do it. So there's a stigmatism behind the Bible in itself. It's boring. It's archaic. I can't live my life. So people don't go to it for that, because either they feel it's outdated, or it doesn't apply to me, or it's going to mean I'm going to have to give up everything that I feel is fun. So they don't go to.
Well, that's what it's been taught, but not knowing that is not really the meat of none of it. But
I
that, yeah, I get it. Yeah, that's the truth. That is not
it's
the meat
no,
of it.
It's no mm-hmm. different than when it's time for you to get advice with certain people. And they want to do something that they know that's going to feel good to them, but it may not be the right thing. They're not going to go to somebody with some wisdom. They're mm-hmm. going to go with somebody who's going to line up with what they're going to do. It's no different. People are not going to go to the word if they feel I'm going to have to change. If I'm going to have to give up something, if I'm going to have to sacrifice something.
Well, I got a question and it was thinking, and it made me think, because we're, you know, kind of like on the marriage thing. From what I've seen for a while now, that a lot of people allow other people into their marriage. How do you feel about that? I don't think that's right. I guess for me, I guess God gave a man and a woman to communicate. So if you're really properly communicating, why should you get to a point where, you know, you are letting everybody into your information, which is into your marriage, which causes more chaos, whether we believe it or not. What do you say about that?
I look at it this way. Go to the word, like you said. And in the word, it says that the marriage bed is sacred. What does sacred mean? What does that word derive from? I think it's derived from, in a sense, of secrecy.
Sacred, yeah.
And so here's the thing. You are to confide in your spouse, like you said, communicate with your spouse. If you can't talk to your spouse, your husband or wife, about how you feel and what's going on, that's a problem in itself. Maybe you shouldn't be married to this person. And I am not an advocate for anyone being divorced, mm-hmm. let me be clear.
Mm-hmm.
But maybe you should really think about, like, I can't be open with my own spouse, the person who I married. Go back to your vows. What does your vows say? Like, the whole purpose of marriage, everything that I go through, you should know. I should be able to talk to you, experience it with you. Death do us part. But people go to other people. Why? They want to feel right in what they've said and what they've done. People are always looking for someone to take their side. People are always looking for people to reaffirm that they're the victim in all of it, that it's not their fault.
And this is where the problem comes in that too, because you normally, if you're going to somebody, normally you're going to somebody that you know, that you're cool with, whatever the case may be. You're telling your story from your perspective, whatever, whatever. So they're going to side with you, make you feel like you're right. So you go home, taking all the energy back home to, whether it's husband or wife, whoever, you're going back to that person in that energy, thinking that you're right when you only gave part of the detail.
On your side
of the story to make that person say, you know what, you're right, he's definitely wrong with what he's doing, you need to blah 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 blah, and you take that energy back home, not realizing, man, you are outside of your authority because you went to somebody else instead of going to your husband or your wife and talking to them. Communication is one of the most valuable, I think. To me, communication is more valuable than love. That's just my opinion when it comes to marriage, because if you're not communicating, how the heck can you love me if I don't want to talk to you about certain things, or I don't want to be open with you about certain things. How do you have love? It's hard though. I ain't gonna say it's hard. I think we as humans, or whatever you want to call it, we put that barrier to try to say, you know what, I ain't gotta talk about this with that person. I'm just gonna, you know, talk with my friends. And then it's like, makes it more, they go out with their friends or whatever the case may be, and they be telling everything. You be like, wow.
This is a feel good society. It's all about feeling good. It's all about feeling everybody seeing it from your perspective, your point of view. But realistically, a marriage is all about compromise. There's two different people coming together. It's about compromising, allowing space for each other to have faults. No one, first and foremost, is perfect. No one is going to get it right every time. And it's working through the situations that, in my opinion, actually makes your marriage stronger. It's through the bad times that makes your marriage stronger, because it's in how you go through it together. You know, you don't really know if a marriage is tested unless you've gone through something. And that's not just a marriage, it's with anything. If you take a phone, right? A case, a phone case, because everybody has phone cases. And you create this phone case and you never test how durable it is. You'll never know how strong it really is until you test it. And that's with everything in life. You don't know how good something is, how durable, how the longevity of anything, how worthy it is until you test it and go through something. And people are afraid to go through the test. But if you go through the test, you yourself see how strong you are. You grow from those experiences. From every failure, you should be growing from it. If everything was just handed and given to you and it was easy, go ahead.
Yeah, I just don't wanna get sidetracked from the scripture, because I think from just say trying to bring it back around to marriages, how Adam and Eve affects marriages, like Eve, like a lot of women, whether you believe it or not, they're more of like, you know, like all the precious things. She had to be caught up in that, you know, the beauty of everything. She had to be able to, willing to say, how the heck could that serpent persuade her if she knew she didn't supposed to do it? How did he persuade her to just say, you know, to keep going, where she even had that thought? But then where the male comes in at, he should have came in and said, put that authority down and said, no, God told us, no, we will not do it. You're going to be, whatever, you done ate it now, that's something you got to deal with, like you said, and Adam should have said, shut it down right there. It's the same thing with marriages, same thing. Not saying that, you know, the man is trying to overrule the woman or none of that crap, because if he's a loving, caring husband, he's going to want to have her back regardless.
Well, how about, let's go back to this. We're supposed to seek God in all that we do.
Mm-hmm.
So, in that moment, you know, we'll say, like, we may not know the answer to every situation. And I think, as a man, there's a lot of weight on a man's shoulders to make the right decisions at the right time, you know. And so... a man is not going to know every answer. He's not going to know what to do in every situation. But it's important for us all to seek God in all that we do. So even in that moment, if Eve came to him and it seemed very, very, very appealing, that's when he should have stopped and said, hey, even if he was unsure of what he was told by God, there was a moment for him to just stop and go back to the Father.
Go back to him, that's it.
That's the same thing for Eve, no offense. There was a moment where she could have went back to the Father. She could have went to Adam and said, let us go.